God's presence this morning. I'm going to try something, even though the young people are not here, they could probably catch it on pretty quick this morning. Let's say this. Thank you, God, for being in our presence today. Are you with me?
Thank you, God, for being in our presence today.
Good morning, Eastside.
Morning.
Good morning, Eastside.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Grace and peace. Thank you.
Grace and peace.
Back there. Passing the buck again. I'm humbled to speak to you this morning, and it's my prayer that we'll get something from this lesson. And I want to talk a little bit about religion and relationship and the difference in that. But we're also going to talk a little bit about being in God's presence. And to get a basis for that, I think we need to get a definition of what religion and relationship is. And of course, one of the elders asked me a question about what I was going to speak about. And I told him, and this is what he showed me in his brilliant wisdom. That's one of my favorite pictures I took of him as we were going to Winterfest last year. But this is what Tom Woodison gave us as far as what religion and relationship is. Religion is a guy in church thinking about fishing. A relationship is a guy out fishing, thinking about God. We're going to go a little bit deeper than that, okay? We're going to try to expand on that definition and get it just a little bit deeper. When I look at religion up, this is what the dictionary told us. Religion is a set of beliefs concerning the cause, the nature, and the purpose of the universe, especially when considered as the creation of a superhuman agency or agencies, usually involving emotional and ritual observance, and often containing a moral code. Try to say that in one sentence. Okay. That's pretty long. Here's what the dictionary says about a relationship. A relationship is a connection, an association, and an involved. We have to be involved if we're in a relationship. A relationship doesn't just happen. It takes some effort on two people's part. And I think that's what God would want us to be. He's here with us today, being present. As Trevor read that passage, and didn't he do an excellent job?
Amen.
The last verse in that chapter says this: "You will make known to me the path in your life, in your presence." If you paid attention to the verses before that, David was so impressed with being in God's presence and how strong that feeling and that emotion was. David went so far to say that he would never leave that path. "I will always stay on that path, and the Lord will be present with me." But when we look a little bit further in that verse, he goes on to say, "There is fullness of joy." If we're here this morning, we should be full of joy, right?
Amen.
Because God is in our presence. He's here with us. And how important that is for us. He goes on to say, "At your right hand are pleasures forevermore." So not just today, not just now, but those pleasures, being in Him, are forevermore. C.S. Lewis penned these words about being in the presence of God. And I'd like to read these to you. He says, I remember once when I had been giving a talk to the RAF, that's the Royal Air Force, an old, hard-bitten officer got up and said, I have no use for all that stuff. But mind you, I'm a religious man. I know there's a God. I have felt Him. Have you ever felt God? Being in His presence. Out alone in the desert at night. The tremendous mystery. And that's why I just don't believe all your neat little dogmas and formulas about God. To anyone who's met the real thing, they all seem so petty and unreal. And C.S. Lewis goes on to give this explanation about what he had written. He says, now in a sense, I quite agree with that man. I think he had probably had a real experience of God in that desert. And when he turned from that experience to the Christian creeds, I think he was really turning from something real to something less real. And in the same way, if a man has once looked at the Atlantic from the beach, and then goes and looks at a map of the Atlantic, he also will be turning from something real to something less real. Turning from the real waves to a piece of colored paper. But here comes the point. The map is admittedly only colored paper. But there are two things you have to remember about it. In the first place, it is based on what hundreds of thousands of people have found out about sailing in the real Atlantic. And in that way, it has behind it masses of experience just as real as the one you could have on the beach only. While yours would be a single glimpse, the map fits all those different experiences together. And in the second place, if you want to go anywhere, map is absolutely necessary. As long as you are content with walks on the beach, your own glimpses are far more fun than looking at a map. But the map is going to be more use than walks on the beach if you want to get to America. What's our ultimate goal as Christians? Where do we want to go to? It's okay, y'all can speak this morning. I'm not the regular preacher, so. Where do we want to go?
Heaven.
We want to go to heaven. So. Did God leave us a map to get us to heaven?
Yes.
He gave us a perfect mind, a roadmap to get there. He gave us a perfect gift of His Son to forgive us of our sins. So now, as we kind of move further into this discussion of religion and relationship, let's look a little bit more about what it means to be in God's presence and how that divide could occur. In Exodus chapter 32, Aaron goes to the people there and says, give me your gold. Moses has been up on the mountain for a while, and they're all getting antsy. Did Aaron know the right thing to do? He did. But he goes to the people, and he says, give me your gold. And he melts it down, and he forms this golden calf. And if you remember, the people started worshiping this golden calf. But what had God done for them? They had been there, they had seen all the plagues. God had led them out of Egypt. And He's given them a sense of direction. But because Moses is up on the mountain for a little bit too long, they start turning away from God. And to me, that's when they started moving just a little bit closer to religion and forgetting that relationship they might have. And if you'll remember, Moses questions Aaron about why did you let this happen? Well, it's the people's fault. Sometimes we have to take responsibility ourselves, you know. And then he proclaims, Aaron proclaims, these are your gods, O Israel, who brought you out of Egypt. As he's holding up his golden calf. You see, they moved from the relationship they had with God closer to the side of this religion. In chapter 33, God, because of these events, threatens to remove his presence from them. Moses takes the time to go outside the camp to build a tent so that they can worship God. Moses goes into the tent, and there's a cloud there, and the people are standing, looking at this cloud. They're in the very presence of God. Now think about taking a city the size of Houston. Pretty big city, right? And directing this mass of people to the promised land. And there's a small portion of it that can go and actually see this cloud around this tent as they worship God. Are in his presence. What do you think that would have been like to stand there and realize that you're in the very presence of God? Because of Moses and what he said, God revokes his threat of withdrawal. He's going to stay with these people, and he's going to direct them, help direct them from the promised land. Here's a little bit of the resolution that's presented in chapter 33. And I want you to grab hold of this question and hold on to it this morning. How many of us want to be in the presence of God this morning? Think about your life for just a minute. He's here. He's here with us. How many of us are actually, let's use the word, joyful to be in his presence as well? How many of us can say, praise God, that you're here? You know, sometimes we think that maybe just coming on Sunday morning, hey, I'm good. Does God demand more than that? Maybe something happened last night or this week and don't feel real good about that. God knows what it was. God is here. So now, if we're in his presence, let's see a little bit more about how we might build and strengthen that relationship with him. I think one of the first things that we need to do is look at our prayer life. Pray like we should. I could have picked out so many verses about prayer. We could have talked, some of them told me to keep it under 4 hours this morning. So we'll see if we can do that. But if you read all the passages on prayer, you'd be here for a while. But I want to read this one that's found in Ephesians. And pray in the Spirit on all occasions. All kinds of prayers and requests, with this in mind. Be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people. Is that everybody? We have to pray for everybody, don't we? For all the Lord's people. Pray also for me that whenever I speak, words may be given me so that I will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel. For which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it fearlessly as I was in his presence. And yet this man is asking, saying, I need your prayers that I may declare that word fearlessly to those that are around me. Paul had a close relationship with the Lord. He was in his presence. But yet he asked for prayers to be given. There's another aspect of this, and that's love. Love is an important step in building a closer relationship with God. And this is one of the passages that I found. But I say unto you who hear, love your enemies and do good to those who hate you. Wow. You mean I have to actually be nice to somebody who hates me? Come on, Jesus. What are you saying? Man, that is tough, tough one. But guess what? As we do it, and as we take steps, we can grow closer and closer to God. You know, last week, I was leading singing. And Seth can tell you this as well, I'm sure. When you're leading singing, you see some different stuff going on around. Dwayne Parker sitting back there, just like he is now, kind of rearing back like this. And I'm in the middle of the verse, and Gordy Brown walks by, right on the back of the head. Dwayne goes like this. I'll confess, almost lost it. I came that close to starting to laugh. Now, Dwayne could have acted in a couple of ways. He could have got mad because he could have whooped Gordy. I know. It would only take him about one out of three falls if he would have still won because Gordy wouldn't have come out for the next round. Or he could say, I hate Gordy. Or what he just did. But you know, they shared a bond, didn't they? There was love there. It still got me tickled. But you could see that relationship building between them. I could use other examples. But as we spend time and we love each other, that bond goes deeper and deeper. What about those kids at Winterfest this weekend? You don't think that bond's not going to draw them closer and closer? It will. They'll remember those experiences. There's another aspect of this, and that is our faith. You remember David basically said, my faith will not be shaken. I'll follow God always, and he'll be in my presence. In 2 Corinthians 5:7. Says, for we walk by faith, not by sight. Sometimes we see things before. David Adamson this morning talked about God's will. And we tried to figure out in class what God's will might be for us. Do we move? Do we change jobs? And all those things. Sometimes we need to walk by faith. Not necessarily by sight. When Jesus tells us to do something, do we do it by faith? Or do we start using our own logic to try to figure out, well, does this make sense? Is this something I need to do? God has a plan for all of us. He has a plan for Eastside. He has a plan for each one of us to live out our life. And where's that roadmap taking us? To heaven. Can you see how some of these steps helps bring us closer to God? And And then there's hope, which is an element of this. And this is one of my favorite passages in the New Testament. 1 Peter 1:3. Blessed be the God and the Father of the Lord Jesus Christ, according to his great love and mercy. He has caused us to be born again to a living hope. That's one that's not dead. That's one that's working on relationships. That's one that's drawing us closer and closer to God. So how do we put these things together? If we continue in our prayer life, if we love one another, if we have faith and we have hope, we will learn other people's needs. We will share with them part of our life. And then what Jesus wants us to do. And as we're in God's presence this morning, it's going to draw us closer and closer and closer to Him. Does it take effort on our part? Yeah. You know, sometimes when we see someone in need, we need to take the first step. I read a book not too long ago about walking across the room. You know, there are people that's hurting, and it's hard to take that first step to go and say, can I help you? Can I share in your life? Jesus never put up any barriers, did he? He talked to the rich. He talked to the poor. He talked to the downtrodden. He never put those barriers in place. So as we work on these elements, we can draw closer and closer to God. Remember that living hope that's there, that should be part of us, that gives us that joy, that helps us to not stay away from doing the things that we need to do and drawing closer to Him. I like to think of it like this. It's not a line that we can draw right down the middle and say, well, over here is just religion, and I do this, and I do this, and I'm okay. I don't worry about building a relationship with others or myself. Or we come over here and we say, man, I've obeyed Christ. I've got a perfect relationship. I don't care. I'm just working in His vineyard. Somewhere in the middle, God gives us rules, commands, moral things that we should do. But He also allows us to work, to be involved in other people's lives, and build a much stronger relationship with Him than we've ever had before. You being here this morning has an important part in building that relationship with your fellow Christians, to encourage them, to build them stronger and stronger and stronger, so that that relationship will never go away. God wants you to have that relationship. He also, right across this slide, that encourages us to pray continually. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. And that's found in 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 17 and 18. To use some language today, pray it forward. We wouldn't have heard that when I was a kid. We use pay it forward a lot. But in this context, pray it forward. Let's go to Heavenly Father. Father, we are so grateful that you are in our presence this morning. that if we have things in our life, that if we have problems that seem overwhelming, Father, we pray that you would give us the strength and courage that we need to build a stronger relationship so that we can walk day by day with you there, knowing that your hand is always there for us to take, for you to walk with us through this life. And Father, help us to feel that presence is real and that it's part of our everyday life as we live the Christian life for you. And Father, help us to be willing to share it with others. We're thankful for your word, Father, and we pray that you would continue to be with us this week. These things we offer up in your Son's name. Amen. Relationships are important not only with each other, but with God. I would encourage you to not only those four steps, but there's other steps that we can take to draw closer and closer to God. This morning, as you look at your life, or maybe there's some things that it's actually you feel like separating you from your God, we'd be more than willing to help you with that. But you know, if you've never obeyed your Lord at baptism, there's a separation. Kind of like that line drawn down the middle. You know, you may be here this morning and you may want to obey your Lord in baptism. We're here to do that. We're here to pray for you. We're here to strengthen you. We're here to try to encourage you in the way we can. So at this time, if you're subject to his invitation, and ask that you come as we stand.